you cannot simply measure THC in order to understand how impaired someone is. I was recruited by the governor of Montana to go run economic development. That was in 2008, which was not a great time to start a marketing firm. What happens when cannabis gets recreationally legalized?
It's the One Podcast.
Hello, One Network members. I got a new podcast for you today. We're starting a series of episodes centered around companies selling to government entities, nonprofits, etc. Different types of business models involving patent, lawyers, regulations, but potentially higher returns than an agency or a typical SaaS. So I think this episode with Ken from Gaze AI is going to be interesting. He was in the cabinet of a governor, and that's how he got his idea for his current company after basically two sort of mixed successes with a marketing agency and a software development agency, which is very relevant to what we do. We commiserate a little bit on having co-founders taking a different perspective than certain guests, and I think you're going to find this episode intriguing for all entrepreneurs. As well, putting out a pretty high pace of podcast episodes, so at least one a day with lots of clips, etc. I don't see the need really to kind of wait on them because we can reclip them and repost aspects later. I want to get all that knowledge out there to you guys who are trying to start startups and start companies today. And I'm not going to play secrets with the podcast. I want to get it out there and get a good content for you guys. But if you have any suggestions for me as to podcast timing or clip timing, maybe you know about social media, I am looking to hire an assistant semi-full-time for that. So please hit me up and let me know. Thanks and enjoy. Into it. So we got another episode of the One Podcast with Ken here from Gaze. I think it's going to be an interesting episode, particularly because we haven't covered anybody who's been involved in the government space or selling to the public sector. And he's got a story, I think, that's pretty interesting as well as a serial entrepreneur. So Ken, do you want to just give a quick background to everybody in terms of your, how you got involved in entrepreneurship and your company?
Yeah, I'd love to. Thanks so much for the opportunity to be here today. My background is a bit weird. As you said, I had a foray into government and now I'm back into the private sector. So it's a bit of a different career story and career arc. But basically, I've always been interested in entrepreneurship. And I actually started my first company about a year after I graduated from college. I started a marketing firm, and that was in 2008, which was not a great time to start a marketing firm. I can tell you that.
Yeah.
And so that was replete with learning opportunities, I'll say. And from there, I moved more into technology. I really enjoyed working with apps and websites and moved more into that space. Ended up founding a company that did mobile development and okay. Web app development as well later in that company. And from there, I was recruited to go run marketing for an infrared optics company. So that was more of a manufacturing space, but a high-tech company that mostly produced parts for the military and defense sectors for infrared optics. And from there, I was recruited by the governor of Montana to go run economic development. And that looked like a really interesting sort of once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. So I took it and ran economic development for the last 4 years of Governor Steve Bullock's administration. When we were done with that, when he was termed out, this looked like the most interesting opportunity that I had stumbled across. And so I put my entrepreneur hat back on and jump into the ring again with Gaze.
Cool. So I do want to get into Gaze in particular, because I think that's, we've had a lot of people on who are in SaaS, different kinds of industries, but nobody in the public sector, who we've been has had experience in the public sector, but I'm having a couple of people on who are in this theme. So I do want to get into that in particular, but just in general, you talked about like 2008, that agency. Were you somebody who was always thinking about entrepreneurship and had kind of side hustles and that type of thing? Were you always in business for yourself? Or how did that kind of come about in the first place?
Yeah, I ended up finding a couple of partners that I wanted to start this agency with, and being extremely naive and not really understanding what the market was telling us at the time, it sure looked like a good time to be starting a company to me in 2007 when we were really in the thick of thinking about that. And then 2008 came around and things were looking a little bit more dicey. We jumped off the cliff anyway and learned really quickly that selling services is hard. It's tied directly to your time. And so the scale is really difficult. And then, of course, the market dynamics were very challenging at that time as well. It was a double whammy in terms of a learning experience for me, but ultimately, I don't regret it. It was where I cut my chops in entrepreneurship and got the entrepreneur bug.
Yeah. Yeah, Ken, I did an agency as well for 6 years.
Oh, did you?
So I understand that. Yeah, I understand the pain there personally, and I came to the same conclusion. And I just got out of it last year. But so you said you started with co-founders. Was that, these were people you knew or that you networked with, or how did you kind of with the co-founders, and like, what was, were they technical? What was the relationship with them?
Yeah, I had worked with one, and then she had brought in a third. And so he was very technical. The one that I'd worked with was not technical. It's another marketing person. And we really focused in on industries that needed some scientific explanation behind them, mostly like health products. And so what we wanted to do was bring our ability to understand the science piece, and then communicate that to the company's customers. And that, we thought that was an interesting niche at the time. I still do. There's a lot of technical products out there, and particularly health products, that are poorly communicated. And a lot of nonsense too. That's a challenging space though. You really have to work within the bounds of what you can do with the FDA and understand those regulations very carefully. And then you also have to, of course, be able to go out and sell yourself, go land clients. And it's a challenging business being in the marketing agency space, but ultimately, as I said, definitely a good experience. We learned a ton, operated for about a year and a half, and then for lack of clients, had to close the business.
Ken, just for like context there, because I think maybe we missed this, what were the types of clients that you guys were going after were? Who?
It was mostly, so some health services like corporate wellness, martial arts.
So that's where the regulations come in, I guess is what I'm getting
at. Yeah. Dietary supplements was another one. So that's really where we had to figure out
claims
and, yep, and what you're allowed to say according to the FDA. There's a specific act that regulates the dietary supplement industry called the Dietary Supplement Health Education Act. And so we had to learn that inside and out and understand how we could market the benefits of the product while remaining compliant with the law.
Got it. Okay. And so then you said you switched it up and went after a software development agency. Do you have a software background, or how did that come? How soon after?
Yeah, we just ended up doing some website work mostly in the marketing agency. I've always enjoyed technical things. And this was right as the phone was being released, and that looked like a really interesting space. And so we jumped into that and started making some mobile apps, and then ended up also doing a lot of web app development, so complex, large website stuff. And that was a good experience ultimately. I had a co-founder in that one as well. He and I ended up parting ways a couple of years into that business. He went and took a teaching job at Princeton, and I got this offer at the Infradopics company. So it was a nice, clear parting of ways at that point. And the company was successful. We made, I think, decent money doing that.
Got it. And how you were doing that, and how long were you doing that for, did you say?
Gosh, I'm trying to remember. I think it was weird. Maybe a little bit more.
Got it. Okay. And a big theme for us has been like the co-founder thing, just like whether you have co-founders or go at it solo, particularly with software, like dev agencies, web dev agencies, et cetera. Looking back, was that a smart move on your part or something that?
I think it was a move of necessity in both of those cases. I didn't have the entirety of the skills required to run the business and didn't have the money to pay someone to do that. And that was kind of the situation there. Ultimately, I think I don't personally enjoy having co-founders that much. So in Gaze, I'm a solo founder. Yeah. I like the ability to have really clear
guidelines and goals.
I'm not so obsessed with control, but I want to make sure that my vision is executed on for the company. And co-founders for me have been more of a nuisance than not, ultimately.
Yes. Yep. Yeah, I was, it's interesting because the past like 5 or 6 guests that we've had on have had co-founders and they were all like touchy-feely about the relationship. Like, then they had really good relationships with their co-founders, but I'm similar to you. Like, that's just another variable that's not under your kind of auspices.
Right.
It's hard to not. I think it just makes it easier when you don't have, when you have an employment relationship with everybody, like you can. Not to be the control freak. Maybe I am. I don't know. But it does make it easier to run. That's just like another factor that's tough. And I get it if you have like great communication and everybody is like very well defined. But I've just found, yeah, it's a lot.
Yeah,
the preference is not.
Totally. I'm in the same boat. One of the challenges I've always had is I tend to outwork everyone around me. So that creating resentment ultimately, and people are maybe not equipped to operate at that same level, unfortunately.
That's interesting that you bring that up, because
I find it's bad for this.
Yeah, exactly. Because it works well when you outwork your employees, because then, you know what I'm saying? Then they see that as, oh, that's motivational. But when it's your co-founders, they look at it a totally different way.
Yeah.
And it can cause some issues. Especially in that, like a service-based company model went, you know what I'm saying? But, okay, cool. So then, I guess, what was the outcome? Did you sell the business? Do you still have that business? Or what happened to that business?
Yeah, we closed it. When both of us had these other opportunities that looked good, we were like, okay, let's just bag it.
Was that a tough decision? Or?
Yeah, it was. We had good clients. We had good relationships. Ultimately, there was some friction with the founder, too, and we ended up, it just seemed like the right move for both of us at that point to wrap that company up and move on.
Got it. Okay, cool. Okay, so then is it right after that you start working for the governor? How does that come to play? I imagine, by the way, that it's like a little, or is it difficult for you to go take a job after being like self-employed for that amount of time or no?
Yeah, it was, but it was also relief too. There's a lot of pressure and challenge that comes with being self-employed, and so being able to go this Infrared Optics company is where I went next, and the opportunity there looked really interesting. So this was an underperforming company that was held by a private equity group, and they were bringing in sort of new management to try to turn the thing around. It had been declining for a number of years after the founder left, and myself and a couple other leaders were brought in to help turn the thing around. And versus hustling for every paycheck and all that, collecting a paycheck was a remarkable change. And it felt really easy to do.
Yeah.
There's so much less pressure when you're just an employee. So it was a mental break in a certain way, but that company, we did successfully turn it around. It's operating today and just very successful. Had a good experience there. I was probably there a little longer than I should have been, but I was looking around trying to figure out what my next move was and didn't see anything that looked that exciting. So that's what happened there. And then from there, I moved on to running economic development for the state of Montana. So that was a totally hard pivot.
Did you feel that entrepreneurial bug? I get where you're coming from there, and that I've heard a similar thing from a lot of people as far as the pressure goes and just like that relief. But do you find yourself getting, while you were there, do you find yourself getting that like bug at all? Okay, I want to fix this myself. Or
I did. I tried to fight it a little bit because I was like, I don't need to.
Yeah,
I don't go crazy too much right now. You know, at that point, I was mid to late 20s, and enjoying being an employee for a minute. But yeah, I always knew I'd get back in entrepreneurship at some point.
Yeah. So then, so you see this opportunity, or how does that kind of, how does everything come about?
I was involved in a group that was advocating for certain candidates. They were basically technology leaders that were advocating for certain candidates in the 2016 election. And one of the candidates that we were advocating for, and this was on a nonpartisan basis, we didn't want to get
sure.
party or another. And so we were advocating for Governor Bullock over another candidate. And ultimately, it seemed like our advocacy really mattered. In particular, there was a couple things that we did as a group that really seemed to move the needle for Steve Bullock. And so when that election was over and he was victorious, he reached out to that group that I was a part of and basically just said, hey, I'm looking to make a change in economic development. Do you guys have any suggestions? And so I didn't immediately think about it. I was not a government guy, and I didn't know really what I would do in that role. But one of my mentors was like, hey, she was also in this group and said, hey, Ken, you should really think about doing this. This is a fascinating opportunity and something you could be really good at. So I took a second look at it and went up and interviewed with the governor, and he offered me the job. And I ultimately thought about it for a couple of days, but I was like, there's just no way that an opportunity like this comes around twice. So definitely looked like an interesting place to take my career. And so I thought I would do that.
So what are the challenges in starting? What are the challenges in this phase?
In my role? Man. Going from relatively small private sector to the top of government, which is a very large organization, is the bureaucracy is a whole different level.
But
lucky though, my group was like a SWAT team for economic development. We were a small group that had a lot of leeway, and we were able to go out and do some really, I think, outstanding work in the couple of years we had that opportunity. And I was really lucky enough to be not sucked into a lot of the politics or the sort of large agency bureaucracy that I think can plague a lot of government employees. So I can't complain too much, but it was a really interesting role, like very public. I was part of the governor's cabinet. So there's all sorts of things that come with that in terms of disclosures and whatever. So it's just a very different thing, but ultimately amazing experience. And I'm really, really proud of the work we did.
Got it. So then where does the idea for Gaze come up?
So while I was in that role, Montana was a medical cannabis only state at the time. And what I was doing as part of my job, my job was so wide reaching, it was crazy. And I was trying to hone in on a couple things. And one of the things that looked like to me it could be really impactful to the state was if marijuana became recreationally available. Okay. And so I was pretty sure that the state of Montana would legalize medical or recreational cannabis if they were given the opportunity. I was kind of alone in that belief amongst the top level of the government at the time. And I felt very vindicated when that ultimately happened. But what I was trying to do is understand, what would the impacts be? Is this a good thing or a bad thing? Do we need to freak out, or do we need to celebrate? Or what happens when cannabis gets recreationally legalized? And so I talked with counterparts in states that had already legalized, like California, Washington, Colorado, and just tried to understand what were they seeing. And ultimately, they said, the sky does not fall when you legalize cannabis. The tax revenue is amazing. You're going to get tens of millions of dollars in tax revenue you've never seen before. So that's really great. It's not broadly caused a lot of problems, but there's one issue that you should be aware of, and that was that there was no device that could check for impairment. And so I had no idea at the time, and that really struck me as both surprising and an interesting market opportunity. What I did at that point was spend the next couple of years as a side project of mine trying to understand why this was an unsolved problem. And if there was a company that was out there that was going to solve it, I wanted to find them and make an investment because it sure looked like they were going to make a lot of money to me.
Were you in this role? Were you looking at things like business-minded and you were looking for problems to solve? So when this kind of fell across your desk, so to speak,
I'm always looking for problems to solve.
Were you thinking in the back, obviously the two companies you did prior to this were like service companies and product company has its own different sort of challenges, but how were you preparing to do that launch and launch a product company or even think about doing a product company?
Well, having done a couple service companies, we developed some apps internally at the app development company.
Got it. So you were able to, I got it. Okay.
I decided I liked products a lot better than services. I was committed to doing that. I'd done a little angel investing too and saw that product companies tend to do a whole lot better than service companies.
Yeah.
So I wanted to find whatever my next thing was. I wanted it to be big. I wanted it to be a product. And ideally, I would love to be the entrepreneur behind it. So this one looked really interesting. And I had ultimately just wanted to make an angel investment. But as I looked around, I wasn't finding a company that was going to do it right. What becomes very clear when you look at this problem is that you cannot simply measure THC in order to understand how impaired someone is. So it works very differently than alcohol does. And so a breathalyzer for cannabis is a very limited value because you can have a beer and drive around. So now you can have some THC in your body and drive around, but we don't know how much THC correlates to impairment. And there has been a lot of scientific study done on this issue because this is such a big problem. And the outcome has been there is no level because of how it is metabolized in the body, how it binds to receptors in your brain, how it's stored by fat in your body and then released over time. So what we needed was a way to measure how the body was responding to the drug rather than how to measure the drug in the body. And as I looked around, the tests that I found that seemed to be most predictive of impairment were these drug recognition expert eye tests. So the track my finger test that the cops do on the side of the road is one example of those. There are six different tests that these drug recognition experts do, and each is intended to elicit a certain sign or symptom of impairment that you can then correlate to certain drug categories. And so each drug category has a unique way in which it impacts eye movement. And by measuring those, the law enforcement officers are able to understand if someone is impaired and if so, on what drug category they're impaired. So what struck me was, man, it's sure crazy that we have humans doing this work. We should just automate this somehow. So that really led to the genesis of Gaze, which is the device is a VR headset that automatically runs the exact same tests as these law enforcement officers do. We have embedded eye tracking sensors that capture eye movement data. And then we analyze that data using machine learning models to recognize the signs of impairment.
Wow. So outside of like THC, has anybody done something similar? Either through software or hardware?
There are a couple competitors that are looking at eye movement and trying to understand impairment. We're the only ones that are doing it the unique way we are. And we actually were just awarded a patent for how we do that. It certainly looks like the right way to me to recognize impairment from cannabis and other drugs. There are a couple other impairment detection companies that are doing different things. Like one has an app that you play a little game and you try to do certain things and it tries to measure your reaction time and divided attention and things like that, memory. Our product, I think, is a totally different way to come at this, but in my opinion, the most scientifically valid way you can measure impairment from drugs like THC.
Got it. Is that something you worry about, like the competition? Are people like stealing your, you know what I'm saying? Just because it's such a unique product.
I used to a lot more. We have such a lead at this point that I think that if anybody else wanted to get into this, it may make better sense to buy us rather than try to build.
Yeah.
We
because the work that went into it and all that.
Yeah. We spent over 2 years building the product, capturing data, creating our algorithms. We did the world's largest clinical trial on cannabis impairment. We have some astonishing customers, frankly, that are using the product today. If I was looking at this, I would certainly, I think, try to buy us rather than build to compete, because between the IP we have and the lead we have, I just don't see how you can catch up.
Yeah. What, I guess, in terms of just like launching the company, was the biggest challenge the product, or what were the really big challenges as opposed to your previous company?
Yeah, I thought this would be so easy to build and launch. And of course it was not. Reality struck about 6 months after the administration was over and I'd been doing this. I was having a really hard time raising capital. Even though everyone recognized the challenge here, the fact that we had a hardware component to our product, the fact that we needed to do a clinical trial, the various rules and regulations we would have to follow in order to do that, all looked like a really challenging thing. And this is even in 2021, when money was pretty fast and easy.
Yep.
So ultimately, we were able to raise some capital at the end of that year. It was due to some local angels, as well as some Silicon Valley angels, that stepped up and, I think more than anything else, recognized this problem and believed in me and my ability to solve it.
Is it the type of business where you have to fundraise? There's no way to bootstrap something like this.
Right. Yeah. We had to do a clinical trial in order to validate the product worked and capture enough data to make the algorithms. And we were able to get far enough down the road to demonstrate that we had the test built. We captured data. We could look at the data, but really couldn't proceed beyond that point with any real validity without a large amount of data. And that requires, we spent hundreds of thousands of dollars on our clinical trial, and it was a big lift. So not something that I was prepared to self-finance.
So I guess going through the company, like what challenges popped up later on after the clinical trial and that type of thing?
Yeah. Once we had the product built, and I'd been talking with law enforcement for a couple of years at this point, the challenge that was most surprising to me was their inability to buy. Law enforcement had broadly not been an awesome customer for us. We've got a handful of deployments, but there are not states that are deploying gays today. And there are a lot of reasons for that. But what surprised me most is that there's law enforcement officials that believe deeply in our product and what we're doing and have the data and understand why this needs to be deployed, but they can't move forward with it because there's legislative hurdles, there's procurement hurdles, there's lots of politics, and big companies like Abbott and Dräger have their lobbyists in whispering in people's ears all the time. And we're a really small company and we don't have lobbyists. So for us to compete against those is really challenging, even though we have the data to back up what we're saying and science is very squarely on our side. Unfortunately, the reality of politics is that a lot of times the big guy wins.
Got it. Yeah. I have a guy on next week who's like a sales consultant, like for people selling based departments and government entities and stuff. But so that I'd be interested in asking him that question. But how do you manage the sales process without those lobbyists? Is it a traditional type of sales process where you're like reaching out?
We've been going direct.
Yeah.
And we've got headsets today and in a number of departments. And I think that over time, we'll get to the big scale deployments like I want to. But what we've found actually is that private industry is buying very readily. And so for 24, we've pivoted to focus entirely on private industry. We're keeping a toe in the law enforcement market. We don't want to leave that market because I think that there's not only a huge problem to solve, but a large amount of money to make. But what we're doing for 24 is we're going to become profitable by selling to private industry, and primarily those are manufacturing and construction companies, also oil and gas, mining. And what they need is a way to detect impairment in their employees.
Make sure
you're driving a crane around, you're high.
Right. Right. Interesting. Yeah. I was thinking the same thing when you were just like describing the business, that like I could see the private sector like all over it, because that's such an issue, like with the drug testing and stuff and all that type of stuff. Okay. So, and then you mentioned like regulations and stuff. Like, how do you deal with, obviously you did clinical trials, but like marketing and branding and all that stuff, that's gotta be like something that's gonna be complex to deal with.
Yeah. Super complex. Drug tests are a unique category at the FDA, and they're not regulated necessarily by the FDA. And so we've actually had to have interactions with the FDA trying to explain our position in the market, and we're actually not a drug test. We don't tell our customers that someone has cannabis in their body. We tell them that they're showing signs of impairment that could be due to a drug like cannabis or a cannabinoid. And so that's a distinct difference and makes us not a drug test. So we're a unique category of device called impairment detection technology, which is, for better or worse, brand new and not something that the FDA currently regulates. So we're threading the needle on that aspect of it, but then there's lots and lots of other regulations in terms of how you can treat employees. At what time can you utilize a product like this, and in what context? And it's all, very complicated. We've had to do a ton of learning, and we've got some really great partners that have helped with that, but we had to do a ton of learning to get up to speed.
Have you dealt with any legal issues?
Not so far. Yeah, I expect that we will at some point. At some point, someone is going to sue us for wrongful termination or being involved in a wrongful termination, something like that. And we're prepared for that. We're as prepared as we can be. We've got all the data. We've got video evidence that's recorded from every test. Our algorithms are extremely accurate. And not that I'm looking forward to that day, but we're as prepared as we can be.
Got it. What's like your long-term vision? Or what are you thinking about as really big? You know what I'm saying? Because you mentioned about your previous businesses and just thinking about what's the next big thing, that kind of hunger.
Yeah. I'm happy inside Gaze today building it. I think that we've got tens of billions of market opportunity here. And so as of now, I want to build this thing, make it big. I don't want to run it forever. We'll either IPO if we get to that scale, or we'll sell it to one of the other big guys. But yeah, my vision for the company really is to create a single device that can detect impairment from any class of drug or fatigue. And so we're doing additional research all the time into additional substances and fatigue. And over time, the product is going to get better and better. It's outstanding today. And our customers have really found it to be a mission critical piece of technology. But there's always a lot more work to be done in terms of refining our algorithms and detecting new things. There's an average of 2 new substances that get introduced each week. The emerging drug threats are really major, getting even bigger. And common drug tests will not detect things like fentanyl or synthetic cannabinoids. So our product is really valuable for our customers when they need to go out and they need to detect impairment from anything.
Yeah. Could you see, you were mentioning like the patent and stuff like that. Could you see other use cases from a company that like acquires you, or other than just like impairment?
Oh yeah, for sure. Yeah. Impairment's the most obvious, right? But our technology can be utilized to detect a broad variety of medical conditions. We're interested in a bunch of different, I don't want to get too far into the weeds on them, but there are a bunch of different medical conditions that you can detect at very early stages in the eyes. And that puts us in medical device territory. So that's a whole different ball game, but definitely a direction that we're interested in moving.
Now that you're kind of like deep in the weeds with this, are there any other like exciting applications for like eye tracking? I was just talking to a guy who had the Apple headset on, you know what I'm saying? So can you see anything? I think it's interesting that there's just so much information that's being encoded by our eyes, you know?
Yeah, I think eye tracking is in its infancy today. There are researchers have been using it for years to like understand everything from where your eyes are looking on a display to how a website performs and a variety of medical conditions, things like that. But you know, we haven't really understood how most medications impact eye movements. For example, most antidepressant drugs and other psychotropic medication that is legally prescribed, we just don't know how it impacts eye movement today. We have theories and we suspect certain things, but there needs to be real study into that. And I think that we can move a huge amount of scientific information forward through our product by learning to understand how these various classes of drug impact eye movement. And then also, of course, the medical applications.
Got it. Closing things out, what's your biggest takeaway for some entrepreneurs? I think it's obviously interesting, just like your path of having those companies that sounds like they didn't go necessarily the way that you wanted to, and then having this kind of crazy bounce back, like being in the governor's cabinet. And what's your big takeaway from that kind of story?
Well, I think the biggest takeaway I would have is to do something that you're passionate about. There's no substitute for being able to wake up every day and do something that you really deeply care about and believe in. And money is just frankly not enough. You can make money more readily elsewhere than by being an entrepreneur. You really have to have some purpose behind what you're doing and understand the why behind it. That in this company is really clear for me. We're saving lives every day. And that matters to me a whole lot. I was hit by a drunk driver in 2019, which really brought this point home. And I think that if there's one piece of advice I could give people, it's find something that you're passionate about and that you really deeply care for and spend your days on that.
Cool. Ken, where do people find you, or how do they get in touch with you, or anything that you want to kind of link to people?
Sure. Yeah. Our website is gaize.ai, gaize.ai. And then I'm on LinkedIn, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, X, whatever. Find me on all those places. Happy to connect with anybody.
Cool. It's the One Podcast. Thanks.